Natchez is here and what it is because of the Mississippi River. It was always the river.
I have a Shangri-La place. It's down on the bluff. And looking up, you see the whole panoramic view of the river.
I love to go to the river and just watch the sun go down. I love to throw rocks in the river and just kind of wonder, where's that rock gonna end up?
You can stand on the bluff at Natchez and look to the north and know you can go all the way to Minnesota. Look to the left, you can go all over the world.
As far back as memory goes, the river is a silver thread tying place to place, people to people.
Once you get beyond sight of the bluffs of Natchez, then the river essentially looks no different than it would have looked to La Salle when he came down 300 years ago.
The Natchez Indians were the last major Indian group to occupy this area before Europeans came in and took over. They used the Mississippi River as a way to get from one place to another and to carry on trade and exchange information. When you look at, for example, Emerald Mound, which was built by the Natchez, you get an idea of the amount of free time these people had.
As the Natchez Indians knew here, each season has its own distinct character.
I used to think that the summer was the most wonderful time in the world. I went in bare feet. I'd get dusty and sweaty, and it didn't matter. It was wonderful.
I like the old hot summer.
Long, lush summers are good for crops, good for fishing, good for visiting.
The first sustained European contact with the Natchez Indians took place in 1682 when the La Salle expedition, coming down the Mississippi River in canoes heading for the Gulf of Mexico, met Natchez fishermen along the river. La Salle spent a couple of days visiting with the Natchez Indians and meeting the tribal chief at the Grand Village.
He was followed by other Frenchmen who set up a fort here in 1716 named Fort Rosalie.
Early on, the relationship between the Natchez and French was a fairly good relationship. There were some conflicts, but overall the two groups were able to coexist. The disaster finally occurred when the Natchez rebelled against the French colony. Through a very brief war, the Natchez were forced out of this area and never really allowed to return.
Natchez also has an interesting complexity of layers. You have an ancient Indian layer. The French culture, of course, came with the French explorers and settlers. The Spanish did a great deal to determine the physical aspects of downtown Natchez particularly. The English made large contributions, and the contributions of African Americans sort of underpinned each group.
People coming, people going, people staying. All of them mark this land.
Almost all of our major arteries in this area are on old Indian traces and trails.
The white man just took over from the Indians and continued to use this trace through the years.
In the old days, the 1700s, under the Spanish, there were some pretty vicious cutthroats on the Natchez Trace.
Out of the Hell was basically the end of the Natchez Trace.
They call it the worst hellhole on the river. A drinking town, a gambling town, and a killing town.
While Under the Hill was being tamed, up on the bluff, Natchez was growing in size and in wealth.
The question is, how did these big old houses get in this little tiny nowhere place? And the answer is cotton. Cotton was produced on the Mississippi River in the greatest concentrations of anywhere in the world at that time, and that it made enormous wealth. And the planters lived not on their plantations, but at Natchez. And it was here they built their great houses. Here they gave their parties, they did their business.
If it had not been for the black people and the shacks behind the big houses, there would be no big houses. Because we tore the land, we planted the cotton, we picked the cotton.
In the land of cotton, fall is harvest time, and the fields turn white.
I love the four seasons of Natchez, especially the fall. All the beautiful leaves, the different hues and colors, and it's just magnificent.
It's cool, and leaves begin to trickle down, and it's a beautiful time of the year.
One fall season, a new sound was heard in Natchez.
Well, the first steamboat, of course, to come down the Mississippi River came down in 1811.
Well, of course, Natchez is a little different from other river towns in that we, in the 19th century, didn't have a railroad or highways, and the river was the way to go.
In 1838, Natchez region produced 40,000 bales of cotton just in this region alone. Had it not been for the steamboats, there's no way they could have gotten that cotton to market.
One of those boats has 8,848 bales on it.
The river is where you hear the calliope even today playing on the riverboats as they arrive or depart from the landing where it's always been down at Natchez under the hill.
It's kind of like a whole 200-year history of the river occurring as you watch them cast off the lines, fire up the calliope, and motor off.
Above the busy river, great houses were rising in tribute to the wealth of the planters and the skill of the builders.
We had a large number of very wealthy people, and most of them chose to live here in Natchez. They built these big homes.
The houses were constructed almost entirely from local materials. For wood, they would go up into the swamps and cut down the cypress trees. For bricks, the slaves primarily were employed. They were often made right on site where the house was being built. That was the case with longwood.
Longwood is the ideal example of antebellum construction. Until about 20 years ago, the hammers and saws and paintbrushes were scattered all over the place where they just dropped them, and for 100 years they hadn't been moved.
The actual construction of the house, we know, employed not only men, but also women and children.
It's almost awe-inspiring to look at some of the buildings built with a lot of slave labor and with hand tools.
Longwood is an amazing thing, especially at Christmas time when all the tiny white lights are out. Take your breath away.
Christmas and winter, a special time in Natchez.
Christmas is always a joyful time in Natchez. The lights are bright and twinkling and sparkling.
Christmas had a special magic in itself for bringing out the best in people. And the city was always a showplace.
The winter is cold, not consistently, but it's cold. It's winter, and we have snow every now and then.
If it snows, of course, we close the town down.
One particular winter became a turning point in the city's story.
During our living history program at Melrose, we depicted the Christmas of 1860, which was a very difficult time in this area because it was just before the secession meetings. And so there was much turmoil and much talk about politics. Natchez was a divided city. It was more Union than it was secessionist. And yet, once war was declared, most of Natchez supported it.
Our homes and buildings were not destroyed, as there were in so many other beautiful southern towns.
We sent 1,444 men off to fight for the Confederacy, and approximately 250 of them did not return.
When the Civil War ended, Natchez entered a new era.
Natchez rebounded quickly. Economically, we did well.
But the Jewish merchants saved this town in the post-Civil War days, really built this town up.
We saw a shift in power from a society dominated by the planters to a society dominated by merchants, where most of our great mansion houses are pre-Civil War. Our downtown is primarily a post-Civil War architectural phenomenon.
As the 20th century dawned, the town was prosperous, but there were dark days ahead.
The boll weevil had come to Natchez in 1908, and it more than the Depression probably, and more than the Civil War, changed Natchez economically.
And everybody, whether black or white, became poor. So much so that when the American Great Depression came in 1929, they hardly recognized the difference.
We couldn't afford to tear down and build modern structures, so we kept what we had as intact as possible.
Even when times were hard, everyone looked forward to spring.
And then comes Mother Spring again, and everything seems to be right with the world.
Spring is so spectacular that it's just almost like nature had just wrapped all of the other seasons into one and said, look at me, I'm beautiful.
Spring is an exciting time because everything is budding and full of life and bees are buzzing about and everything is just beginning to bloom.
I like spring best of all, and that's when we have our pilgrimage too.
It was spring, 1932. When Natchez, for the first time, invited the world to visit.
It was the Ladies' Garden Club that started the pilgrimage back in the early 30s, and it was the ladies who started saying, well, maybe people would really pay to come see these things.
We grew up in these houses with this furnishing and with the silver and the crystal, and we used it every day, and it was nothing unusual. In the houses during pilgrimage, you have the hostesses that dress and tell you about the various things in the house.
As people were cleaning up their houses and putting flowers in them to show them to visitors, that became the time to entertain.
I think pilgrimage has been marvelous for the town. It has really preserved us, not only with the houses, but with all the buildings and with the history and with the whole thing.
The streets of Natchez are eloquent with buildings that speak of continuity, time, and the human spirit.
The churches of Natchez are really magnificent. It's a great collection of all the styles of architecture, almost, that were popular before the Civil War. The largest of them all is St. Mary's Cathedral, the Gothic edifice, constructed in 1841. The very chaste and massive qualities of the Greek Revival Church at Trinity Episcopal are themselves the epitome of the Greek Revival architecture. And then the very prim and proper style of the First Presbyterian.
Most of the people who live here in Natchez have a certain pride of being who they are. Natchez is always like pageants. It's typical of Natchez to want to parade, to show off, to have a good time doing it.
One of the interesting things is the Confederate pageant. That's all local talent.
And I remember my costume there. It was white organdy with a white lace bonnet and deep velvet green ribbons that tied under my chin, which itched and scratched.
It's wonderful for the children because it gives them a self-presence. Performing gives them a certain amount of self-confidence. They complain about the ballet slippers, but they put them on.
Natchez children, I think, because of this constant performing they do from the time they're 3 years old, they never lack self-confidence.
In Natchez, celebration is a way of life. Music, history, and the Mississippi River. All of these come together in one Natchez event, the Great Mississippi Balloon Race.
Instead of going out to a large field remote from town, our balloon race is held in the historic district. and the thrill is watching the balloons sail among the historic buildings and go over the Mississippi River.
If it's a smooth river that day, you also get the perfect reflection of the balloons in the river.
Natchez and the River. The story lives on.
The southern charm of Natchez, the beautiful homes, nice people, and it's just a combination that's hard to beat.
We've had everything that's made this country great. Every nation, every group of people are just part of this quilt. It's hard to walk away from something like that.
It's been a wonderful life. I wouldn't want to be anyplace else.
I've been in Natchez all of my life. I've never felt the temptation to live anywhere else. And if I were tempted, I still wouldn't do it. So, it's Natchez.